sustainable houses and how they are sustainable and the aim of these buildings, why they should be sustainable and how they work. Thank you.
Okay, we're just give me a second here to see what we can find. All right, I got it here. Okay, so do you have questions you want to start with, or you just want me to run you through what we're doing?
Yeah, just an introduction about sustainability, and then just an insight into your buildings, your sustainable buildings, how they work.
Okay.
The perspective.
Can you see that on the screen behind me?
Not everything. There's the top part missing.
The top is missing.
Yeah.
How about that?
Yeah, it's better.
That's better?
That's better. Yeah, thanks.
So is that a halfway decent visual?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. All right, so you all, we have some students here too. So anybody can ask questions anytime, but I'll just run you briefly through what we're doing. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we're working on sustainability for everyone, really, on this planet, and trying to make pathways for everybody getting to it. And we have this phrase we call sustainable autonomy for everyone, safe, kind of a way to look at it. So we're looking at making the earth part of the buildings and the buildings part of the earth. And you end up with these Amazon rainforests inside the buildings that treat the sewage and provide oxygen. In other words, they're like biospheres. The buildings are like biospheres. The reasons we're doing this kind of thing are this. Now, we see stuff like this around the planet, and we're trying to make it so we don't need this. So, are you all hearing me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, we're getting some kind of little feedback here, but I guess it's okay. Let me know if it's not working.
Yeah, it's okay here. Yeah.
Okay, so we're responding to this kind of thing and this kind of thing. Sewage dumping into the waters and garbage burning. And we're just responding to this kind of stuff. It's basically for our own behalf. We're not liking what we see, so we're trying to make things better for ourselves, and it turns out that you can't really make things better for yourselves unless everybody's involved. The nuclear power plant that failed in Japan is now destroying the whole northern hemisphere. So what we're saying is we have a model, a tree. When you see a tree, you know, it's a good thing. And when you see lots of trees, you see a forest. That's a good thing. Never hear anybody say there are too many trees. Now, when you see a person, okay, they're not bad. But when you get a lot of them together, you get this. So we're trying to be more like trees on this planet. And instead of these aliens that seem to just destroy them. So we're looking for guidance. We're looking for guidance in nature, I guess is how you would say it, to keep us from doing things like this. And we look all over planet at what we're doing, and we see things like this. Rather than seeing things like that, we do this to the planet. And we're just observed here and saying, well, what the hell, you know, let's try to do something different. We're doing it for ourselves, but we're seeing that there are lots of people on this planet that agree that we need to change our direction. Look at this. This is the Caribbean, you know. We destroy wherever we go, really. And like I say, we need to be more like trees. We need a model. We need a guide to tell us what to do on this planet. This is in the Caribbean also, stacks and stacks of bottles, mountains of bottles, mountains of plastic bottles. And what we're seeing is, if everybody agrees now, they didn't even used to agree, but now they do agree, the path that humanity is on this planet is headed for a big bump. That's kind of an undisputed fact right now. But nobody's got a solution. They just, well, the path that we're on is headed for a bummer. What we're saying is there's no path. We don't have to go to the bummer. We seem to have made a path for ourselves because of karma, politics, religion, and all of that. But we don't have to follow the path. Go any one of 1,000 different directions, there's no bummer in there. It's only the path that we've established head toward the bummer. So we're looking at you know, getting a concept in our minds first about what is going on. And you know, here's another one that works for us. You can't see it too well probably, but it's, if all the soldiers in all the armies in all the world, just imagine that all the soldiers and all the armies in all the world put down their weapons, picked up tools, and started building carbon zero housing for all the people in the world, our problems would be over and real life would begin. It's just as simple as that. These are pie in the sky, Don Quixote thoughts, but gotta start somewhere. We're essentially recruiting an Earthship army all over the world, and it's actually happening. The war that we're fighting is against Monsanto, nuclear, big gas and oil, pharmaceuticals, politics, tradition, regulations, religion, economics. You know, we're not really fighting war, we're really just trying to transcend those issues on this planet, because they all lead to the bummer. So what we've come up with is what we call an Earthship. It's housing as an independent global vessel. It's a vessel. Just like a vessel, like a ship sailing on the sea, that ship is carrying people. It has to have food for the people, it has to have toilets for the people, it has to have comfort for the people, it has to have electricity for the people. So does a ship that sails on the earth. Same with a spaceship. When you go out into space, the spaceship has to provide you with everything. It's a vessel that provides you everything in space. We're looking at housing that way, looking at housing as an independent global vessel on the earth. And it started 45 years ago, damn near 50 years ago now. We started looking at garbage on this planet and deciding maybe we could build out of garbage rather than trees, because we need trees and we don't need garbage. Look, garbage is a natural resource. That was one of the early thoughts. This is the building that was built out of these beer can building blocks, the old steel beer cans, ages ago, and this is what it looks like today. It's still standing. It's the first garbage building, built out of beer cans. We went on to build lots more trial and error buildings out of garbage. We got into pyramids and the energy that's there out of aluminum cans. And pyramids encountered the solar system, really, if not the universe. And so what we're saying is we want to encounter the phenomena of this planet for our life. And there are phenomena on this planet that are unarguable. We did practice flying somewhere along the line. But early on, 40 some odd years ago, we were trying to take garbage and make buildings that captured the sun, and we were just experimenting. We had to go out in the middle of nowhere to do it because it scared people. You know, buildings made out of garbage and pyramids and stuff, so we had to go way out to try all this stuff out. But we did. And it led us to building, to looking at garbage, cans, tires, bottles, cardboard, lots of things. It led us to looking at to garbage as a resource of this planet. That does two things. It gives us a new resource that we don't have to manufacture because it's already manufactured, and it gets rid of this thing that we don't, that we have invented. We have invented garbage. If we use it, like when a leaf drops from a tree and turns back into soil, plants and animals don't have garbage. Humans invented garbage. I'd say let's take it one step further and dissolve it back into the planet for something like buildings. So we made lots of buildings that encountered the wind and the sun and rainbows. And we were just trying to encounter, to try and make architecture encounter the phenomena of the planet, which is wind, sun, rain, and everything else. All these things of physics and biology. So we had lots of buildings like this out in the middle of nowhere, trying to encounter the earth. I did start drinking somewhere along the line. We ended up about 30 years ago making a building that we called an Earthship. Because we had been through all of this, and we made a building that was just a series of spaces that faced the sun and were built out of automobile tires because that's mass. That's that building. It's about living, and lived in it for 30 years. It's the first Earthship. We built lots of them. This is one for a movie guy in Colorado, Dennis Weaver. They called it an Earth yacht. It was so big. He thought he wanted to be an example for people on this planet. And I said, is a 10,000 square foot home really an example? But still, it made monumental steps toward introducing this thinking. We wrote books, other people did them. I have never even seen this building in person. It's built from our book, Earthship Volume 1. We went up into the mountains, and where there was no power, no water, no way to do septic, no, people said I was an idiot for getting land there. They said, you can't build up there. We built up there. Up on the steep slopes, 45 degree slopes, we caught our own power, caught our own water, and contained and treated our own sewage, and the buildings heated and cooled themselves. This was the beginning of a building that fully encounters the earth, that can be built anywhere off the earth. Because mostly people have to build buildings near power lines, near infrastructure. What we're saying is you don't need infrastructure. Infrastructure is destroying the planet anyway. You want to get away from infrastructure. So this is a little village we built way up in the mountains. That was the beginning of Earthships. You can see the slope. You can see banana trees growing at 10,000 feet. We did get into a lot of trouble because we were breaking every rule in the book. So these are just headlines from a little war we had with the state of New Mexico and the county. And we get into pretty good place with the officials, and then a new regime comes in and we're in trouble all over again. In other words, it's like a constant war with dogma. It's not really people's fault. People have created dogma, and dogma attacks us every once in a while. This community that we're in now, this is an Earthship community here in New Mexico. We made a community out of these buildings. We make the building lots circular so they float on the land, essentially. And that leaves room for animals and plants and snakes and spiders and everything to still live there with us. We don't make all the lots. Those circles are all lots. We don't make the lots touch each other. We think that the rest of the planet should be developed this way because it allows for the creatures that were already here to still be here. In this community, that is working. That's a herd of 60 elk walking through this community like they owned it, because they do. We don't own the earth. Everybody owns the earth. Sandhill crane, they get to land here and live here. So we're sharing the planet. That's one big humble step that humans need to take. Instead of just taking it over, paving it and taking it over and building fences. So we have a lot of buildings that we built on this planet we experimented with, and they are all buildings that address this effort to encounter the phenomena of the earth to have a life. And like that building there, you know, it's dead of winter, it's totally warm inside. These buildings stay at around 70 degrees Fahrenheit without fuel. And they harvest rainbows. And another thing we did as a result of all our encounters with the government, we made a law. It's relating to the conservation of natural resources, enacting the Sustainable Development Testing Site Act, providing for the approval of areas to be used for non-industrial research and testing designed to reduce the consumption of and dependence on natural resources by residential development. This was law, and we made it into law. It took us 4 years in the legislature to do it. It's providing specified county codes, ordinances, rules, and permits are not applicable to certain research activities within an approved area. We're just asking for a testing site. They tested the atomic bomb in New Mexico and blew 10,000 acres to smithereens. They test drugs, and yet they have to put warnings out to test the drugs because they're going to cause you to start bleeding out your ears and other orifices if you take these drugs. They test automobiles. They test planes. Why can't we test housing? That was our argument, and we won it finally for 4 years. The governor signed it into law in March 2007. So all of this fits together it came about under the heading of architecture. But there is so much pomp and circumstance with architecture that there were two reasons we decided to walk away from architecture. One was in my war with the county and the state, I relinquished my architectural license in New Mexico and couldn't use the word architecture anyway. And two, architecture is not keeping up with, standing up to the problems that we have now. Architecture is still doing architecture. So we invented a new thing called biotecture that can go where no man has gone before. You know, it's that kind of thing. That's what we need to do with a profession that involves buildings for people on this planet. We need to go where no man has gone before. Architecture doesn't want to do that. Architecture's got a lot of bullshit tags along with it. Biotecture doesn't. So biotecture is achieving sustenance through the encounter of earth phenomena. That's the definition of biotecture. Earth phenomena are wind, rain, sun, gravity, condensation, thermal mass, lightning, rainbows, all aspects of biology and physics, and much more. These are the phenomena we're not going to control, we're not going to harness, we're going to encounter. We're going to encounter them to have a life, like a surfer encounters a wave. Try to, take a surfer and have them try to harness the wave. Good luck. You have to have humility and respect for the wave to be able to ride. You have to have humility and respect for this planet to be able to ride the phenomena of this planet. That's what the Earthship is. That's what we're trying to do under the heading, the profession of biotecture. And again, our model creature is a tree. It's a tree. A tree drops its leaves. They aren't in wrappers. They aren't in plastic wrappers. They drop, turn into dirt to make more trees. A tree has a root system that that reaches down and gathers water. Piping system, so to speak. A tree puts out oxygen that animals need, us included. And the animals put out CO2 that the tree needs. It's kind of an exchange of breathing in and a breathing out. And a tree, of course, has an electrical system that called photosynthesis that sucks up energy from the sun. So we're trying to say the tree is really our model, because it sits there and does everything. It encounters phenomena of the planet or life. We want to do the same. We don't want to do what we're doing now. And so then we take that and we say, what do we as humans need? I've come up with, and I have worked for a long time, 6 points of that humanity needs. Every village, every city, every country must address these 6 points for the humans to have life. Water, no brainer. Energy, we could go back to living with no energy, but we use energy. This computer is using energy. Cell phones use energy. Hell, we were in Haiti and there were 14 people living in a 10 by 10 tent, but they all had cell phones. We're not going to go backwards. We need energy. Water, energy, we need to contain and treat our sewage. Humans are really crazy. They're the only creatures on the planet that collect up all of their sewage and put it in the same place and then try to deal with it. That makes it a huge problem. If there is each home, each building is dealing with its own sewage, it's a small problem and it's easy to deal with through biology. So we got water, we got energy, we got some way to treat our human waste. Some way to treat our solid waste, our garbage, because we just produced it constantly. And food, of course, and last but not least, shelter. We need comfortable shelter without fuel. There is no way any group of people can have any kind of a life unless they address all of these things in a way that is good for them and good for the planet. We're sort of addressing them these days. We're putting sewage into the oceans and rivers and bays and streams. We're putting chlorine and fluoride in water that we put in pipes and mine out of the mountains or the wells of the aquifers. We're making energy by recreating the sun on the planet in form of a nuclear power plant that gets out of control and destroys the whole planet. We're not doing this in any competent way at all. So we're saying, we don't want the corporations to do it. We don't want the government to do it. We don't want to use what they're doing. We want to make this for ourselves in our vessel called an Earthship. We're going to encounter the phenomena and have as good, if not a better life, and people that are getting it through the infrastructures of corporations and government. So we take these 6 points. Like I say, it's water, it's contained sewage treatment, it's food, it's building garbage, using garbage as a natural resource, it's thermal solar heating and cooling, portable shelter, and it's energy from the sun and wind. And the buildings that we make do this, this is one such building. It's a vessel, it's an Earthship. This is inside of it. It's a jungle, it's an Amazon jungle, and it's here in an arid, dry desert. But all of this happens with no fuel. They can look fairly normal inside, if normal is what you're after. These are Earthships. These are the vessels that we're making. They are on sort of a high-end or flamboyant level. They are on a average level, and they are on what we call a very simple survival level. Just like automobiles, you can get a compact car, or you can get the Cadillac, whatever it is, deluxe, whatever. Compact cars are pretty smart these days. Compact homes are coming, believe me. So we'll take a look at these 6 points. Building with natural and recycled materials, we use tires as bricks, as adobe bricks. Thermal mass and structure. That's what it looks like after it's plastered. They're fantastic in compression. This is a loaded 8-yard concrete truck on the 2-course tire wall. They're easy to do. This is up in Ithaca, New York, where a couple just did their own tire work and had us come do the rest of the Earthship. This is a retaining wall in southern Argentina, Ushuaia, made out of lorry tires. Tires are indigenous to the entire planet. We're using them as a building product. So are glass bottles. We're using them as a building product. We're making stained glass bricks. All over the world, bottles exist. If you look at these as indigenous natural building products, then you just use, okay, trees are natural building products too, but we want trees, they put out oxygen. Bottles and tires and cans are natural building products. We don't want them, we don't have anything to do with it. So now we use them and keep the trees standing. And it's easy to use the bottle bricks. You can do all kinds of things with them. This is in Guatemala. This is in New Mexico. They become stained glass art pieces. And then where you don't have glass bottles, you've got plastic bottles. This is in Sierra Leone. School, we did a school in Sierra Leone. This is Philippines after the typhoon. These products are indigenous to the entire planet. Everywhere we go, we always find tires, cans, bottles, and trees. But we don't use the trees, we try to leave them. Plastic bottles look like sand dollars. They can be beautiful. Glass bottles and plastic bottles. Cans are building products. So glass bottles, plastic bottles, cans, we make buildings out of them, and with tires too. And there is an abundance of these materials all over the planet, and the skills that it takes to do this are much less than the skills of our manufactured sheetrock and all kinds of other concrete blocks and masonry and the stuff that we manufacture to build with. This stuff is already manufactured. It's second use. So these buildings are just coming up from the earth, made with products of the earth. If you came here from another planet, glass, cans, tires would be natural products, that natural things that happen here on this earth. This is Jamaica, we do it all over the world. Another thing that you find a lot of, and I found it in every country, refrigerators, stoves, washing machines, these appliances, people use them for a few years and then throw them away. They got these fantastic panels of metal that have a coating on them that'll last forever. We make shingles out of them. And I did some body work on my Mercedes with them. And the Mercedes, of course, runs on grease from the bars and restaurants. Straight grease poured into the gas tank, strained through a t-shirt. Bottle caps used in grout joints. It's just showing that everything, cardboard in the Philippines, used as insulation. And so you got these natural building materials. Wood, stone, mud, plastic, glass, tires, they're all natural. We make buildings. We don't exclude the other natural materials, but we include cans, tires, and bottles as part of the natural materials of this planet. So we go into the next one. It's solar heating and cooling. The dynamics of that is basically we're building the building into the earth and bringing the sun into it and using the mass of the earth to stabilize the building. We have developed a configuration that does this in any climate. The heat comes in from the sun, it's trapped in the thermal mass. And as the temperature leaks back out of the glass at night, the mass that stores the temperature releases the temperature that was stored in it. It's physics, that heat goes to the cooler place. So the heat in the room goes into the mass wall. Water back to the beginning, So you're recirculating the water through the same filter all day long. And the result is bananas growing in your living room. This is basically, you see this picture, this, think of this as a sewage treatment system in your living room. You know, no wonder they took my license away. This is sewage in your living room. It's growing bananas. And it's taking sewage into the rivers and streams. So all of the Earthships have a jungle inside of them to treat sewage in the living room. That's a little hard to handle for a lot of architects and engineers. So the system is conventional. This is a diagram of a conventional system. We just add our botanical cells to it, and we can turn them off or on. If we want, if we turn them off, we can show the authorities, here's a conventional system going to a septic tank and a drain field. When they're not around, we turn our system off. It's as simple as that. We tell them what they want to hear. Here's how it looks in your living room, looking out through your windows at a foot of snow with bananas growing in your living room from your sewage system. And of course, it's food and oxygen. So it's in all of these encounters cause a lot of things to happen at once. So every Earthship is a jungle inside. The newer ones, you're even more of a jungle because we get more food, more sewage treatment. The little pump panel run by the sun that recirculates the gray water all day long. The black water goes out to a septic tank and into other botanical cells. The point is, no sewage ever leaves the premises. Every building deals with its own sewage, completely contained and treated. And here's what it does to your building. This is our high mesa desert. And this is shortly after one of the systems was put in place. This is a few years after it's been in place. It's attracting creatures that wouldn't normally be there. And it's making a jungle around the building now. Then you get into food production. That's a result of your sewage system. There's just endless food that you can produce in these buildings. And we produce fish as well. You got melons, you got cucumbers, you got squash, peppers, tomatoes, strawberries, all kinds of things, broccoli, even mushrooms, squash, root crops. We get to so much we have to dry some of it. Tomatoes, salads. You can live in one of these buildings. There's mushrooms growing in the buildings. Chocolate, figs, you can stay alive in one of these buildings. Now, that's the point, stay alive. And all of this food is the epitome of organic. Now, this food's not grown for money. This food's grown for us to eat. You know, there's no carbon footprint. You crack the watermelon and eat it right in your own yard, in your own house. Cantaloupe, pineapples, at any given time, get any of this food you want from these buildings. Artichokes, papayas, I think, eggplants, grapes. We have parakeets in there. One of our worst problems in these buildings is that blue parakeet is eating the grapes. So we had to kill it. We're human. We have to keep under control. Chili peppers, bananas, of course. This is, people will question immediately, well, what about growing food in gray and black water? We took it to Dr. Francisco Diaz-Gonzalez at the University of Minnesota. He tested it, all kinds of fruits and vegetables, and it tests low measurable on E. coli. The way you get E. coli from human waste in gardens is when they put it on top of the garden, which some people do. That's ridiculous. When it goes through this process of plant roots, it's natural, and so it's a nutrient. And we also, due to the fact that we have a tropical climate, we grow tropical fish for some protein, unless you're vegan. And I don't know if there's any sound on there.
To illustrate that you can catch a fish out of the pond in your own home, and cook it and eat it. And that's what we're going to try to do. So you have to kind of let it float up there a little bit like that. Put it in this way a little. minute? About 30 seconds.
Oh, 30 seconds.
Chicken Hill. And this is the building that does all of that in a flamboyant way, like I say, and we have to make this available to people in a more generic way, like automobiles, you know, like a Toyota Corolla. We have to make all of this available in a vessel that is appropriate. And that's how we have come up with what we call the global model ship. This one we call Phoenix. It had pulled out all the stops. It's just doing it in the most outrageous way possible. But everybody can't afford this. So we can do this to show ourselves what can be done. And it's a lot of fun. And it is a nightly rental. People stay in it. This is a waterfall that has a fireplace with a waterfall in front of it. So the Phoenix is a jungle, it's a botanical gardens. It's using all the recycled materials and all the concepts. And people get to stay in. It grows tilapia, grows chickens, grows turtles, grows frogs, and all kinds of fruits and vegetables and flower. It is the earth captured in the building, basically. It's encountering the earth for sure. And we, like I say, we use it as a nightly rental so that people can experience this, not just as words, but as reality. But we have to put it into something that people can afford, and that's the global model Earthship. The global model Earthship is everything you've just seen, but it's put into a building that is right in the same price range as any well-built home anywhere in the world. Even up in the mountains of Wyoming, we've done them everywhere. This is Brighton, England, a little cluster of them in there. Georgia, Holland, we've done them everywhere. France, Montana, here in New Mexico, Baja, Mexico. This is again here in New Mexico. These buildings are the generic version of countering the earth in a vessel that people can afford. And you know, some people can't even afford this, but this was our first step, get it into a form that could be like a Toyota Corolla. And it's housing as an independent global vessel, the global model Earthship. And then, this is a ground up of it. I'm going to pass on that because it's just going to the nation showing these buildings being built. it is definitely worth looking at. Tires go up and the insulation goes up, but we'll move on from that, because we'll move on from that. What's this? Nothing, apparently. People do ask if this can be done on a multi-level scale, and we have not done it, but we have a plan for it. In an urban situation, anybody can build a parking garage. So we can just build a parking garage. We call it a land assemblage. It's an assembly, an assemblage of land, essentially. And we're not going to park cars on the back of it, but we slip in to global model airships. And they're just the same that we built in Montana, in Holland, in France, anywhere. We just build that into the parking garage. You can do it. This one shows it 3 stories tall. You can do it 20 stories tall if you have the space. We just slide in the global model ship to a parking garage. And you have parking, because everywhere you go, you need parking in an urban area. So we're giving them some parking, and we're giving them some sustainable housing that is tried and true and proven. It's the global model airship. It's the custom. It's the same building we've been building all over the world. There's a sketch of it used for a ski valley application, condos in a ski valley. And you can take these and add larger greenhouses to them in areas that are more severe. This is in Turkey, village. Now, if you're going to build a village like this, you're going to have to spend a few years and a few million, if not billion dollars, doing infrastructure, power, water, sewage. We can start this village tomorrow without infrastructure, because every building is its own infrastructure. And the transportation through the village is on bike trails that go through the greenhouse sewage treatment plant. Your transportation to and from other units in the village is through the sewage treatment plant. Then on with the urban application, we have sketches for one that may happen in New York City. It's a global model ship on top of a 6-story tower. It's called Urban Sky Autonomy. There it is on the actual site. There's 3 of them on a vacant lot area on Pitt Street in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. Ridiculous in a certain way, because it's not efficient. You want to pack as many units as you can in there. We're saying it's not about that. It's about having people in a city that aren't dependent on power, water, and sewage from the city, because Hurricane Sandy in New York took them away completely. If this was there at the time, would have had people not worried about their existence. Hurricane Sandy was quite a catastrophe in Manhattan. And one other thing, we take it into the ultra, ultra simple compact version, using the same principles, but we call it Simple Survival. We have made an app on Simple Survival that's in your app store on your iPhone, on your Android, that shows drawings that you download and send to your computer, 11 by 17 drawings, construction drawings, because if you can't afford a regular home, you can afford a compact home, and you can't afford an architect, so you need to be able to download a set of drawings, 4 or 5 different sets of drawings are downloadable. 20 and 40 page sets of drawings are available on this app for the Simple Survival Earthship. This is getting it to the people that can't afford an architect and can't afford a Toyota Corolla. It's the Simple Survival Earthship. It comes in all kinds of forms, from concrete. We built them all over the world. And you can use them in cities as well. And you can use the global models and the simple survivals in the cities, in the clusters, in the villages. And we've done projects demonstrating these all over the world: Scotland, Bolivia, Japan, Mexico, Spain, Scotland, Czech Republic, Germany. That's a global model in Germany. New Zealand, simple ones, Canada, Hawaii, Bonaire, Jamaica, Nicaragua, India after the tsunami, Guatemala, China. Every country has these indigenous materials. And you're looking at either the global model or the simple survival model. There's a huge difference in price. This is Haiti after the earthquake. It's a simple survival model. All the systems are super simple. Everything is ultra simple. Trying to make this available not just to wealthy people, not just to common people, but to the many, many people on this planet that are really the majority of the people on this planet have minimal money. And these versions of simple survival earthships are available from them. We even use flush toilets, which are cheaper. Everything is cheaper. Everything is less expensive, let's call it. This is the Haiti version, making cities out of it, villages out of it. And that's just kind of the overview of what we're doing. So we can take questions from our group here or from your group there.
It's still in the second.
Thank you. Is there any other questions? We have to send the questions by message because apparently that always doesn't work.
I think he's still.
Can you hear us?
I can hear you.
Oh, okay, that's great. Perfect.
Hi, can you hear me from here?
I can hear you.
So I've been looking at earthships for a long time, and the one thing that I haven't seen added in is a biogas digester between the conventional sewage system and the biocells. Do you think that could be added in, or is that
going to
make the system too complicated?
No, it's there is no problem with that. It's not rocket. They do biogas in a lot of places on the planet. But the reason we haven't included it yet is we're down to the point where we use gas only for cooking. And we do use it sometimes for backup hot water, but in a lot of places we need it for backup hot water, and in a lot of places we don't need it for cooking because we're cooking with solar ovens and eating raw food. So we haven't had the demand for the gas yet. We know it's there, and it's a matter of it's on the list. Are you all getting that feedback, or am I just getting it?
Yeah, it's perfect. We can hear you. Thank you.
Okay.
Ask him how long it takes to build one.
How long does it take to build one average earthship?
Well, you could say we've made it pretty simple. It depends on the design. Are you using a simple survival design or a global design? We put them up about 4 to 5 weeks with about 50 people when we do it. Like a 2-bedroom home can be done in 4 to 5 weeks. A simple survival can be done in 2 weeks. It depends, but it's no slower or faster than a regular home, except that we have made it into components and repeat designs and lots of people. We've gotten it to where you can throw one up, you know, in 4 or 5 weeks.
And how much does it cost?
Well, I went into, they can cost anywhere from 25 grand to a couple of million. It depends on what you choose. It's like an automobile. If you choose the teeniest little compact mini car, it's going to be cheap. If you choose a Cadillac Eldorado, it's going to be expensive. So it's what you choose. But what I'm saying is that we have to, and we have made a major attempt at doing this, we have to make this technology available to all financial stratas. And that is the wealthy people, the common ordinary people, and the people that don't have any money at all. which is why we put out the app to just give it everything we've got for simple survival is in the app for $9.99. Whereas global model people can afford to pay $10,000 for a set of drawings, and wealthy people can afford to pay $50,000 for a set of drawings. See, the set of drawings for wealthy people is more than not wealthy people have their whole house. We have to make the pathway to countering the phenomena of the planet for sustenance available to everyone.
Any more questions?
Can you ask me about the seismic and flood safety?
What are the seismic and flood safety measures that you have in your data?
The seismic aspects of these buildings, well, first of all, let me say that FEMA did a few years back, came to New Mexico because they expect more earthquakes in this area in the future. And they did a seismic study on all the alternative methods like straw bale, adobe, earthship type buildings, conventional buildings. And they put an earthship on the cover of the report because it was the one that stood out the most as having the best possibility of withstanding an earthquake. In other words, when an earthship tire wall moves with an earthquake and the seismic activity, the plaster will crack. But when you imagine earth-rammed rubber tires stacked on top of each other in a running bond, the structure of the wall can't crack. A concrete block wall can crack all the way through, and then you've got a structural crack in addition to a plaster crack. In earthship, you only get plaster cracks, not structural cracks. That, in addition to the fact that most of them are very low to the ground and buried into the ground, laced into the ground, so the seismic activity, unless the earth opens up right through the living room, the seismic activity the building finds itself resilient and moves with the seismic activity to a certain extent, more than almost any other structure system for residential.
Any more questions?
In terms of maintenance or livability, can someone on a tight schedule manage to live with it with an easy amount of control?
The early model earthships, it was like sailing a boat. You had to do this, you had to do that, and we learned very quickly that that's not user-friendly, and it's gonna deter people from choosing this direction. So what we have done in the last decade is made them pretty much less maintenance than a regular home. You have filters to clean twice a year. You have batteries to check the water on twice a year. You don't have painting because the building's buried. You have glass and on the front that doesn't deteriorate. In other words, and the roofs are mostly metal now, which is a lifetime roof. The earthships of today, the global model earthships of today, I would have to say, easily they are less maintenance than a contemporary home. And certainly less money to operate. The people do buy gas in these buildings to cook with and dry clothes with. They hang in greenhouse. So the worst scenario operating cost of a global model earthship is about $120 a year total annual utility bill.
Tell me a question. What energy storage does he use?
What kind of energy storage do you use?
We use, for the electricity, we use lead acid batteries still. We're looking at the salt batteries, the salt water batteries. and they are probably going to be incorporated into Earthships within the next year or so, but they are still three times as expensive as the lead acid batteries. So we have to get the cost down on that application. We will probably use the salt water batteries in our buildings, our demonstration buildings, but it's always about economics. And people will not use things that cost three times as much, the general public. So the bottom line is we'd rather have people use lead acid batteries than a nuclear power plant.
Anyone else? Well, it doesn't seem like there are any more questions. So, thank you for the guest lecture.
Okay.
That was very interesting. Hope you all enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, bye.
Bye.